everyone. Greetings. Greetings, brothers and sisters. What a fantastic turnout this is tonight. You know, on a weekday night, I think this is brilliant that there's this amount of people, multicultural audience, that are here united against the far right and against the EDL specifically. And it always inspires me and uplifts me and gives me hope when I see a group of people come together against racism, because I spend every day of my life fighting racism, you know, in society, in the workplace, against the far right, and sometimes it gets you down, being in that situation, having to fight racism day in, day out. It's actually quite depressing. So seeing this group of people here ready to stand up and defend our multicultural communities is fantastic. Black Activists Rising Against Cuts, the campaign group that I represent and co-founded, is an anti-cuts group. It's a national anti-cuts group with regional structures up and down the UK and also in Scotland. And we founded BARAC because we knew that the cuts, the government cuts, were going to have a disproportionate impact on black workers, black service users, black communities, and on deprived communities across the board, not just black communities, but in the poor people who are in the poorest areas, most deprived communities and geographical areas, are the people that are going to be hit the hardest by cuts. And part of our work in fighting the disproportionate impact of cuts and the racism of cuts is to campaign against the far right, because we know from history that in times of austerity, the far right blame migrant people, they blame black people, they blame Asian people for the cuts. They don't look at what the government are doing and how those cuts are coming about. They blame us and say, we came, we took all their housing, we took all their jobs. It happened to my mum coming from the Caribbean to this country in the 60s, and it's repeating. History's been repeating every decade with all the different groups of people that have come into the UK. Actually, all of our groups, all these different groups of people that come into the UK have experienced the UK. We've actually, supported the UK. We've created jobs. We not only just filled the jobs and filled the posts that other people didn't want to do, we create job opportunities. We help the economy with the things we do in the UK. I think that we inspire a whole range of people, and actually lots of our culture, aspects of our culture, have become part of UK culture, whether it's music, whether it's cuisine, a whole range of things. So we strengthen the UK, and actually that should be something that's celebrated. And the EDL claim to be specifically anti-Muslim. They try and say we're only against Muslim people, so then everybody else can come and join us because we like everybody else. But we know that's not true. We know that their hatred expands way beyond Islamophobia. But even if they were just Islamophobia, that's not acceptable. We need to stand up against that. Through history, we've seen different groups of people demonised by fascists. And, it was Jewish people in the UK and the East End. And by the way, I've also come from Plaster. I don't come from there, but I live in Newham. Yeah. So I'm a South Londoner at heart. So, and I live in a very multicultural. I'm here to warn you, East Enders, don't say it all. I'm at heart because I grew up in East. I grew up in South London. But actually, the area I live in now, Newham, and the area I grew up in, Southwark, are very multicultural communities. So I've always lived in a multicultural community. And that's where I feel safe, where I feel confident, and where actually a lot of my inspiration comes from. And in terms of the creative things I do as a performance poet, as a visual artist. And I'm happy to be living in a multicultural area. I think it's the most positive place for me to be living, for my family to be living. And we need to stand up against any racism, any fascism. It doesn't matter who they say they're targeting. We need to be there and we need to stand up every time. Because if it isn't us, today, it could be us tomorrow. And if we're not there standing with other people, then they'll be coming for us the next day or the next month or the next year. And I think, talking about multiculturalism, it was very interesting to see the leader of the Labour Party a few days ago giving a huge speech defending multiculturalism, particularly talking about his own multiculturalism, and promoting diversity. But he wasn't talking about this community or my community in Newham and the multicultural communities that make up the UK. It was in opposition to Scottish independence. So it was quite interesting to see the one time he's speaking out in defence of multiculturalism was against Scottish people having independence and not in defence of the people that are under attack and under threat from the cuts from the far right. And we must remember that it isn't just the cuts that are attacking us, it's not just the far right that are attacking us, it's the government we've got here today. Government that said multiculturalism had failed. Multiculturalism was dead. If multiculturalism failed and dead, the UK economy, which is already in trouble, will completely fall apart and be non-existent, because the UK relies on many, many different groups of people who've come here to work and settle down, you know, for the economy to keep going. And, you know, we need to stand up every time we hear a racist comment or we observe racism, because it isn't just about building for the far right, you know, to campaign against the far right, which is essential and is important. But what we've seen, because we've got a government that doesn't care about equality and is quite racist in their policies and views, we've got a right-wing media that actually make things worse with the things, the lies and myths they put out in their publications and on TV, and the you know, combined with the far right, that has emboldened people that have got racist views, but perhaps didn't express them. Because you're not always going to change the views of an individual, but it's about what they do with those views and how they use those views and how that impacts on others. We've seen, because of the modern media that we've got now with people recording on their mobile phones, several incidents where there was vile abuse on trams and on tubes, racist abuse. And that would, those people would never have been found and caught and dealt with if somebody sitting there hadn't been recording what they said to create the evidence. And the reason why those people feel strong and bold to express those racist views is because of all the other things that are happening in our society. So part of what we must do, I believe, is that we need to continue to speak to people and dispel the myths and lies and actually, you know, arm them with the truth and the knowledge about what's really happening out there and what's really happening to our communities and who's to blame for the attacks on our communities, the hospitals closing down, the libraries closing down. We need to involve everybody in our community, you know, that we live in, here in Waltham Forest. You know, whether it's young people, it's elderly people, all the community centres, the faith groups, involve everybody. The shops, you've got a big market here with a diverse range of people running those market stalls and those shops. I think we need to involve all of those people. And, you know, hearing about the events that are planned and seen on the chairs, that you know, there's a music event. I think cultural events are very important, because sometimes not everybody will come out to a meeting like this. And I know, because people speak to me every day about it, that some people are fearful of going to a protest, you know, a counter-protest against the EDL. And I think we need to address that. If there are people that are fearful, one thing that will give them the strength and take away that fear is when they see a huge amount of people united, but also when they see people from their own communities, their own faith groups coming out and being part of that campaign. And we need to ensure that the security, the safety is there for people. They have the confidence to come. They're, you know, bought along in groups. They're taken back in groups, so they feel safe and they feel confident and they feel protected when they're in there. And actually, hopefully, they'll also feel invigorated and confident in the future to stand up against the far right. Because racism is not any joke. You know, I know that I've been attacked by the National Front, and I thought my life was going to go that night. And it's terrifying. It's terrifying. And when you're having it from every aspect of your life, when it's happening in the workplace, when it's happening in the services that you're trying to access, it does get you down. And that's why we need to be there to support everybody that experiences racism. And when we challenge, when we don't challenge racism that we hear on the street, down the pub, you know, in whatever it is, in the library, we hear throwaway comments, it means that people do feel empowered and bold and think that's okay to say that. I'll continue to say it, and then that expands and other people say it. And when we challenge it, it will make people think twice about going and saying those things that they say. So I think that's important. I wanted to flag up a couple of things because my time is nearly up. And on the back table, there are some mission statements for BARAC, and that tells you how to follow us on Twitter, join our Facebook, join our email list, and we would encourage you to join. We want everybody to join. You know, we're building structures all the time. We need to fight the cuts. We need to highlight the impact of the cuts on you know, those that are hardest hit. And also on the back table is a guide for our activists in PCS in campaigning against anti-racism and anti-fascism. There's not a huge amount of them, but there's several on the back. And this is actually a practical guide that we've created for our reps, for them to take away and say, this is how we campaign on these issues, but also to arm them with the knowledge of what PCS does as a union nationally. And I think to finish, we've got what we need to stand up against the EDL. And one of the things that happened in Tower Hamlets is before the EDL even got to Tower Hamlets, we found out where they were planning to have their protest. And when it was the Sainsbury's car park, we used people power to put pressure on Sainsbury's to say, if you let them go there, then we're gonna boycott you, and we're not gonna use you, we're not gonna shop with you. And when they went to go up to a park, then we went to the, you know, the local authority and said, if you're gonna let them go in there, you know, this is going to be challenged. And so it's about not just standing up against them on the day when they come, it's about doing everything we can to stand up against them in the run-up to that, and to put the pressure on the organisations or individuals within this borough that are happy to allow them to come in, which includes the police, actually. So, you know, you need to be strong. Our multiculturalism, let's celebrate our multi-faith, our multi-races, and see that as our strength to stand up against the far right and the EDL.